SigMarch has come, ladies and gentlemen. Expect not the grimdark future of the 40-somethingest millennia, nor the slightly less grim but also slightly more grim darkness of the 30th millennia. We shall leave behind the science fantasy setting of 40K this month, and return to a place where men, elf, and dwarf stand together against the forces of chaos and more. Right before immediately turning on each other. Gotta have a war between friends after all, it's called Warhammer. And with the beginning of this most monumental month, I have decided to cover none other than the original realm of united mankind. That's right, you corpse worshippers, Sigmar and his realm were first. So to start off the month strong, let's go through the do or don't that you all have been waiting for, and by you all, I mean myself. Prepare to hold back the forces of chaos, beat down the greenskin tides, and play babysitter to the most entitled Holy Roman Empire nobles you've ever seen. And of course, what video about the Empire of Man would be complete without the four most powerful words ever uttered by an emperor of a Warhammer setting? You know the ones.
Summon the Elector Counts!
Do or don't, Empire of Man! Hell yeah, let's go! I'd just like to say before we start that yes, this video will have actual in-game footage. For the sake of expedience, however, the lore bits are largely gonna be still images from fantasy. Show gameplay when I talk about gameplay. That's my plan so Sony Vegas doesn't melt on me. Anyways, let's go, baby! Empire of Man, I am hyped! The Empire of Man is the greatest realm of mankind in the Warhammer world. Sorry, Cathay, you're kick-ass, but Sigmar's realm is something special. And I shouldn't have to tell you that they're better than the Bretonians, of course. I would tell you that, but it's still too close to the beginning of the video for me to comfortably break out the words I'd use to describe them. They are the mightiest nation in the Warhammer world, surpassing even the elegant approach to warfare of the High Elves or the thunderous barrage of Dwarven artillery. This is partially because both those races helped teach the Empire, and partially because the Empire isn't crippled by either a genetic adherence to tradition nor being stuck in the middle of an ocean regularly being invaded by their asshole cousins. The Empire of Man is ancient by human standards. It has stood tall for over 2,500 years. Not always standing soundly, mind you. It's based on the Holy Roman Empire, which means it's filled with about 10 or so major provinces and dozens of minor, squabbling nobles, all of whom hate each other to varying degrees, and sometimes three of them decide to be emperor all at once, which leads to a several hundred years long civil war. Thankfully, this is a setting where evil murder Vikings exist. If you're wondering how in the hell anyone could be thankful for that, it's because nothing brings people together quite like an army of demons threatening to eat the souls of all of reality. Of course, by the standards of most of the other factions in the Warhammer world, even the human ones, the Empire is a nation of newborn babies just barely figuring out how the world works. Given that most of the Chaos followers in the setting are humans, perhaps they have a point, but it's usually mankind who ultimately defeats Chaos, so I'd say it's even on that front. It was formed roughly 2,500 years prior to the setting, when Sigmar Unbarogan united most of the human tribes of the Old World under his banner. Some didn't come together, such as the Tylaeans or Astalians, due to geography. Others, like the Bretonians, thought they were too good for the man who could defeat Nagash all by himself, because of course they think they're too good for him. Dickheads. Speaking of coming together, though, Sigmar saving the life of a Dwarven High King ensured that not only would the races be allies for the rest of time, but that the Empire would get limited access to all sorts of goodies. Like gunpowder. Now that's a real handy gift to give your neighbors. It would keep trucking on for all those thousands of years. Every now and then, like I said, there'd be horrendous disasters, such as a Greenskin, or Skaven, or Chaotic, or Bretonian, or God knows what else invasion to deal with, or a massively incompetent Emperor who did something like embezzle massive amounts of funds into parties and feasts while the Empire starved around him. Or the guy who let Marienburg succeed from the Empire, the single richest port in the Old World, just gone. But then an emperor like Mandred Skaven Slaver or Magnus the Pious comes around and everything goes back to being good again. Sometimes they'll even make serious gains in the way that the Imperium never really manages, at least not for long. Magnus the Pious pushed Chaos back, not just survived the invasion, but pushed it beyond its pre-war boundaries. He also set up the Colleges of Magic, with some elven help, of course. Sigmar founded an everlasting friendship with the dwarfs, and Mandred butchered so many rats that for hundreds of years they never invaded the surface world again. Overall, the Empire has broken up the status quos in ways that you might not expect from a Warhammer setting, until the end times, but for once I'm not talking about that. This is a total Warhammer video, the only end times are when you turn off the game for the night. Now they're under the rulership of Karl Franz, the greatest statesman of the Old World and all around best human being to ever exist, real or fictional. Truly the only perfect being to ever exist in any of these settings. Snorri Nosebiter's a close second, but just escapes being first because I cry whenever I think about him. I can assure you, Franz will be getting a video all to himself, but for now let's just leave it at Karl Franz. Kicks an unbelievable amount of ass. So why go for the Empire of Man? Well, for lore attractions to the Empire, if you enjoy playing as the common man beating back forces well beyond any normal person, you want the Empire. The average state troop is just some guy given either a gun or a sword and told to go fight that rampaging bloodthirster, and they usually win. Even the heavier hitters like greatswords are just stronger dudes waving around a bigger sword. The wizards may be magical, but beyond that, there's nothing special about them. No legendary prophecies about them for the most part, they can just kind of throw fireballs around. They use power that, while safer than in 40k, ultimately derives from hell just to push back the darkness one more time. And yet, while they are just normal people, for a fantasy faction, they're still pretty unique. Because they're well past the medieval age, unlike some backwater, brain-dead, bumbling Bretonians I could mention. They're well into the Renaissance and even beginning the very earliest stages of the Industrial Revolution. True, this is causing all sorts of civil strife, such as the window tax riots, which kick off Gotrek and Felix, but it still gives them a lot of unique flavor. Which is, by the way, a really funny way for a fantasy adventure series to kick off, isn't it? Some dude rallying a bunch of people to protest taxes of all things leads to a legendary hero surviving the end of the world. But regardless, this gives them some pretty unique flavor when it comes to a fantasy setting. You aren't just carting around bows, arrows, and the most knightly of lances, you've got goddamn cannons. You have rockets. They're shitty early stage rockets that stabilize themselves with a stick and the prayer of the guy launching them to not turn around and explode in his face, but they're rockets nonetheless. In addition, there's no hold on technological advancement, at least to the extent the Imperium has. Yeah, a lot of people are suspicious about new technology in the Empire, but consider this. In real life, we know that when a storm blows in, it's because of weather patterns or boring crap like that. In the Empire, the average person might blame it on an evil wizard, and there's a decent shot that they're right. Plus, when researching new ways to smelt metal, you never know what might be the formula for a new mixture of metals that'll create the mightiest armor yet, and what's gonna cause a greater demon to pop out of your refinery. I can't speak for any of you, but I'd rather not get jump-scared by Kugath. They take it a lot slower because in Warhammer, research is a genuinely risky affair, but they don't completely stop it. So the Empire of Man stands above the majority of nations in fantasy settings for this reason. How about this? Do you like Warhammer, but wish the people in it weren't always the stupidest ones on the planet? Because the Empire of Man is exactly what you want then. Well, yes, the Elector Counts are squabbling morons, and Chaos Cults are just as rampant in the Empire as in the Imperium. At the end of the day, the average Imperial citizen can be relied upon to do their damn job and fight back the undead, chaos, and more. Their leaders understand that other races aren't just to be obliterated on sight. Much can be gained and learned from cooperation with them. Even if it's just a business deal with the dwarfs. Just make sure you don't short them a penny. They'll be a bit angry about that. They fight side by side all the time, with Teclis helping push back the Great War against Chaos and the dwarfs helping put a stop to Manfred von Karstein at the Battle of Helfen. Plus, someone who always rises above to stop chaos or vampires when things are bleak. It isn't like 40k, where the Imperium eventually wins by virtue of having infinite manpower to toss at a problem until it drowns in corpses. The Empire wins through the brilliant and valiant efforts of both its people and its greatest leaders. So if you want a history of intelligent people kicking ass behind your faction, here you go. Jumping off that last point, the Empire of Man is firmly in the category of Warhammer good guys. They're at the forefront of the wars against Chaos, and frequently the Orcs and Skaven as well. Even if it takes them some time to get their act together, they fight to the last against the threat until it's defeated. Now with that being said, they do share a lot of things in common with the Imperium, who are very much not good guys. Witch hunters regularly condemn people to their deaths for a reason that may or may not be valid, mages are mistrusted if not outright hated by many, and the citizens do not all have the best living conditions. But there's a few things about the Empire that make up for these negatives that the Imperium lacks. For one, scale. A witch hunter killing a few people is hardly the same as an inquisitor burning down an entire planet because one guy got a little bit too into his smut in order to demonet body pillow. Additionally, the Empire is not a future science fiction space empire that in many cases should probably know better than to be an asshole. It's a Renaissance era civilization, which means while most of the upper class and growing middle class are well educated and whatnot, superstition abounds in a very large number of the population. Remember the Salem witch trials, where some people freaked out over witchcraft and killed a whole bunch of other people? Imagine that, but in a world where witchcraft provably exists. It would be a lot more understandable of a reaction in that case. Plus, the living conditions being shit is more forgivable because, again, it's Renaissance/early industrial times. They were awful for most people in real life, of course they're gonna be awful here. The average Averland peasant not having a great life is a lot more understandable than the Imperium just accepting that thousands of planets are literal hellholes and that's an ideal state of being. It's the Renaissance. Even if the Imperial nobles wanted to ensure everyone lived in luxury, they probably wouldn't be able to do so. And the leaders of the Empire generally love their country and people. A lot of time in 40k, you get the feeling people do something horrid not because they feel it's the only choice, but because that's just what they're supposed to do. Whereas people like Karl Franz admit that what they're doing is very dark. They know that they might not have the moral high ground, but it's all they think will work to let them survive another day. It may be a small difference that ultimately doesn't actually mean anything, but at least in the world of Warhammer, I think feeling bad about what you've had to do is the difference between being another shade of villain and being a morally gray hero. Now, gameplay, the part where I finally use gameplay footage in this video game video. I'm sure you're all so excited. Now's a good time to mention that I have a few mods. Most of them are small. One adds occasional lore blurbs when you recruit a unit for the first time or capture certain settlements of certain factions. One gives every character an extra skill point on a level up, which also affects the AI, so it's not cheating, it just makes the game advance quicker. That's how I justify it anyways, maybe I'm just scum. Recruit defeated legendary lords because I do not feel bad about cheating to get Marcus Wolf after he dies 100 turns before I could possibly confederate him. Oh, and Malachi McKyson. He's not terribly balanced and comes with a massive airship at level 20. But he's just one guy, the airship doesn't come till he's level 20. And either way, I'm not turning that mod off because it's a Gotrek and Felix mod and I'll cut off my own taint before I don't include a Gotrek and Felix mod if I can help it. Anyways, overly defensive tirade over, let's talk gameplay positives. Why go for the Empire in Total Warhammer? Well, if you're a Total War veteran, I've got a very good reason right off the bat. You know how in Rome the Romans weren't technically the best at anything, but generally shit-stomped everyone anyways? For example, barbarian armies usually had higher melee attack, but Rome wasn't too far behind and their defense was so high that the barbarians couldn't get through anyways. Or how the Greeks may have been better on the defense, but Roman defense was good enough and their offense was a lot better than the Greeks, so they lost much the same. It's a similar case with the Empire, even if not as extreme as in Rome. Sure, you aren't as good at magic as the High Elves, Slaan, or Tzeentch, but you've got 8 schools of magic at your disposal and at the end of the day, a comet being cast at only 90% efficiency is still a goddamn comet. Sure, the Bretonians have better cavalry, but you have cannons. Just shoot the assholes in the face. Yeah, the dwarves have better artillery than you, but you have the wonderful ability to flank things instead of just standing there and hoping the enemy gets hit by enough organ gun blasts that they can't come into melee range. As the Empire, you are never short on options. You can choose to specialize in almost any field and it won't be handicapping yourself. A primarily cavalry army is viable. Primarily artillery is viable. Focusing on magic can work, and while their infantry is probably the weakest part of their roster, an army of greatswords is still gonna pack a decent amount of punch. And guns, as it turns out, are quite good at killing things. To follow that up, there's nothing in the Imperial roster that's particularly weak, at least in terms of getting what you pay for. Great swords are just fine at chopping in enemy units, halberdiers are a good anti-large unit, and the Reichsguard and Demigriff Knights are some amazing cavalry. And the artillery is actually really good, even if it's outweighed by the dwarves. Did you know that a doom stack of Hellblaster volley guns is gonna kill most of the faction's main infantry? Because it is. And it's absolutely glorious to behold. Eat your heart out, Tchaikovsky, because Balthasar Gelt is your biggest fan and he's giving one hell of a performance. And speaking of Gelt, with him included, you get wizards of every main lore of magic. Choosing him as your faction leader also gives all units plus 10 to armor, which isn't the biggest buff, but early game it makes your average swordsman fighting a zombie a lot stronger. Who knows, it may even be the boost you need fighting against chaos warriors with your greatswords, giving them just long enough to let your wizards or artillery finish them off. Of course, this video isn't analyzing any one lord's start super in-depth, more so the Empire in general. That being said, I'm sure you could guess who I'm gonna be using to demonstrate the Empire for this video. This is Karl Franz, Prince and Emperor, Elector Count of Reichland, and all-around cool dude. Get him on Deathclaw and you have yourself one hell of a beatstick, especially once you give him Unbreakable so he never ever routs. I'm sure you'll find no shortage of people telling you how he's not the best legendary lord because he isn't the hardest hitter, or the tankiest tank, or because he doesn't provide one incredibly specific buff to your faction that allows you to cheese the AI 6.9% more efficiently. But while I don't have footage of what I'm about to tell you, because this happened well before I was making videos, let me tell you a story. In Total Warhammer 2, I fought a battle as the Empire against the Vampire Counts that was a very close call. The AI had an absolute assload of units on the field, so despite my artillery laying into them, all of my troops ended up dead or fleeing the field. All except one, our Lord and Emperor Karl Franz and his trusty mount Deathclaw. Now he was a flying unit, which meant that since he was the only one left, his leadership would automatically lower until he fled. This mechanic exists so you can't just rock up an entirely flying army and then bully someone with little to no ranged attacks or flying units of their own. Except Karl Franz was unbreakable, so the debuff did nothing to him. I cycle charge what was left of the Vampire Counts until the army losses penalty kicked in and they lost the battle. So for anyone who tells you that the Empire's legendary lords are bad, tell them that sometimes the cheesiest, most ward-saviest lord isn't always the best choice. Aside from that, the Empire's status as the all-rounder faction should not be taken to mean that they don't have any real big hard-hitting units like Greater Demons or Giants. Allow me to introduce you to the humble steam tank. In the lore, there were only around a dozen ever produced before the schematics for it were lost, and only about 8 of them I believe is the number remained functional. In Total Warhammer, as long as you can pay for more steam tanks, you can have as many as you want. Get Karl Franz, a life wizard, and 18 steam tanks to rush the Franzer division across the old world. Is it economical? Not in the slightest. These things devour your money. Is it viable? Maybe, maybe. But is it funny to see a Renaissance-era civilization learn the finer points of Blitzkrieg? Yes, it is, which means it's entirely worth doing. Also, the Demigriff Knights. There's some Danfime cavalry and common anti-large or anti-infantry variants. For cavalry on a lower budget, the Reichsguard are fast and hit hard and can use them well into the late game without handicapping yourself. For some overworld positives of the Empire, their buildings and units require very little planning to be effective. Cathay's harmony mechanics are very engaging, and they can give you a massive buff if you keep everything evened out. But sometimes I just want to plop down a money building without thinking of how it'll affect my nation's stability 20 turns in advance. So while you might not get the most effective benefits out of the Empire, it's very simple to use what they have and get a return on your investment. Their buildings are relatively cheap and give you solid returns. That's all I can ask for out of a faction. There's never going to be a point in an Empire campaign where you have to sit there for 5 minutes considering if that 8% increase to provincial income is more effective than a building that just gives you a flat income. Thank God, because I hate math. Same goes for the buildings that produce higher tier units. You build yourself an armory, and then you build whatever military building you want. Done. Now if you have the money, you can afford your stuff. No worries about unit caps or any of that crap. Their tech tree is also simple with not a lot of filler research. Now yeah, it is kinda dry and it'd be great if they expanded upon it more, but at the very least the benefits of each tech are solid, so it isn't a bad tech tree. Research things quicker, infantry have more armor, give yourself an increase on how effectively you purge corruption. Each of these are their own tech and you don't have to slog through much garbage to get to them. I like the dwarf's massive tech tree because filling it out makes my monkey scientist brain happy, but a lot of the individual ones are very minor benefits that can be annoying to have to spend 3 to 4 whole turns researching for a grand total of 4 extra leadership for units with shields. Thanks, Thorgrim, really bringing in the reckoning with that absolutely astounding buff. The Empire doesn't have stuff like that. The tech tree could be better, like I said, but as it is, it does its job, and that's enough to put it in the pro section for me. Plus, they can get a massive up to relations with any of the factions you can reasonably expect to ally with, as well as tech that lets them fight better against certain types of enemies. I recommend doing the Bretonian one first. Now, you might think I've lost my goddamn mind advocating for friendly relations with the horse fuckers, but I assure you, that's not the case. A 70+ relationship bonus with them means that they won't be stabbing you in the back. This lets you keep them alive as a meat shield while also ensuring your western flank is at least somewhat secure until it's time to show them the power of Imperial artillery. This is assuming you're playing as Franz or maybe Gelt, depending on where you expand. Otherwise, just ignore this tech. By the time Volkmar or Wolfhard come into contact with Leyencore, the only messages you should be sending him is a Grail Knight's head on a stick. And at least in regards to Karl and Gelt, securing their provincial homeland is relatively simple. Destroy the Empire secessionists and you've got Reichland secure. Get rid of the Greenskins in Solon and the province will probably be fine for the time being. While I'll certainly be coming back to the Empire provinces and their safety, your starting province at the very least can be relatively simply secured to ensure you've got a solid base to work with. Again, for Gelt and Karl. Wolfhard and Volkmar's starting positions, well, secure certainly is a word. Not one you can apply to them, but it is a word. At least they're not techless. Finally, allying with people. Because of those aforementioned research buffs, getting allies with the Order factions is actually pretty easy. And in Warhammer 3, allies are actually worth something. Yes, forming a military alliance with Tyrion means you're still going to be dragged into a war with Malekith that is at best completely pointless and at worst actively hurting you. But it also means you'll be recruiting some high elf units into your roster. Sisters of Avalorn work quite nicely in making sure Vlad stays dead this time. And of course, the Empire's stalwart dwarf and allies are more than happy to lend a few slayers to France's cause. Why wouldn't they be? You'll be fighting the same enemies sooner or later. Might as well send the crazy naked axe murderers to help out the Umki. Thungrim's a cool guy like that. As for why it's an Empire-specific bonus, it's because of those researchers. I know the dwarves can get similar bonuses to diplomas with Order factions, but nothing to the extent the Empire does, although the dwarven ones are free. It's very lore-friendly too, since the Empire is usually the rallying point for all these factions. Now, what about the lore downsides of the Empire of Man?
Well, as the Empire, you're usually going to be on the defensive in the lore, and keep that in mind for when we get to the gameplay cons, because Total Warhammer is quite lore accurate in that regard. But to stick with the lore for now, the Empire rarely expands much beyond the boundaries of the various provinces it already has. Sure, it happens sometimes with the occasional attempt to get some power in the border princes or something like that, but those are the exceptions. Quite frequently, the Empire is the one doing the defending against the various threats opposing them. Those outposts and the border princes rarely go anywhere productive. Now, granted, this being a video game and not tabletop does mean that this downside isn't as impactful, but I like to think about the lore of a faction when I pick them, even in Total Warhammer. Maybe I'm just weird, but it's what I do before my playthroughs. And of course, the Empire is largely just standard humans. I do think that they're special as far as fantasy settings go, but if you like to go with the more fantastical elements of a fantasy setting, then yeah, the Empire probably isn't for you. They've got wizards and people riding on griffins, but they're still just normal people. Hard to say they're more fantastical than the elves bringing a hydra to the battlefield under the command command of their 10,000-year-old leader, you know? At least Carl Franz doesn't have the daddy and mommy issues of Malekith, so he's got that positive going for him. Naturally, there's also the fact that if you want to play as the bad guys, the Empire in fantasy is one of the furthest things from it. None of their problems are strictly with any ideology they have. Rather, it's like I said, where they're an early industrial civilization. Yeah, they could be nicer towards mutants, but by Warhammer standards, that's nothing. And things like I want to live another day and their merchants and rulers are a bit greedy kind of pales in comparison to I want to destroy the entire world and drag it ass first into hell. No matter how many times Marcus Kruber complains about Carl Franz stealing his hats, the Empire's not the bad guys here. And for all my talk about them being intelligent, the Elector Counts squabble back and forth with no end in sight. Sure, the highest levels of the Empire have their shit together, which is more than you can say for a lot of Warhammer factions, but below that there's a whole lot of shenaniganery going on that really doesn't need to be happening. And like I said with the first point of this section, you should remember that when we get to the gameplay cons. In fact, let's get to the gameplay cons. I'm sure there's more things wrong with the Empire from a lore perspective, but I play favorites on this channel, and I'm not planning on stopping that anytime soon. What hurts them from a gameplay standpoint? Well, to keep the Rome comparisons going, the Empire's all-rounder status is much more nuanced than in Rome. If a barbarian faction has a unit with 30 melee attack and 10 defense, the Romans had 25 melee attack and 25 defense for their equivalent unit. It was not at all impossible to have Rome's hard hitters and the barbarians' hard hitters get in a 1v1 and the Romans come out on top. That will not happen with the Empire. If you get an artillery duel with the dwarfs are winning unless you get incredibly lucky with the Hellstorm rockets. If you get into a melee brawl with the Warriors of Chaos, they're gonna be winning hard. While you can specialize as the Empire, you need to make sure it's in an army tailor-made to fight a certain faction, otherwise you'll need to play into their status as the all-rounders to outmaneuver their enemies. Their non-legendary lords are also astoundingly mediocre. Generals are the most cookie-cutter whatever lords on the planet, warrior priest lords are neat but they're nothing that's gonna blow your cock off with excitement, and huntsmen exist. Honestly though, their biggest problems aren't really anything to do with their unit roster. There's issues, yeah, like they could use a few more mid-tier units in my opinion, but nothing that really falls outside of the blanket statement of good at everything, best at nothing. There's not much I feel I can validly complain about. Besides, I'm not gonna complain about Carl Franz's performance on the battlefield. He doesn't let you down, you let him down. As for the Empire's campaign though, yeah, I got some stuff to complain about. Once again, this is gonna be covering mostly just Gelt and Carl's experiences because they're what I consider to be the baseline for the Empire experience. The basic Imperial authority system is... bleh. Let's go over it. You've got three numbers to keep track of. Fealty, Imperial Authority, and Prestige. Fealty is how each Elector Count feels about you. There are random events that can raise or lower it, returning a settlement in them after Khazric turns their hamlets into soup raises it, and when it gets to 10, you can confederate them or put it off to gain one Imperial Authority, which incidentally is the only way to confederate as the Empire. Except for Marienburg, but they hate you. Good luck confederating them. Imperial Authority is how strong your position as the Emperor is. When you have one or more, you get some slight buffs. As it degrades, you get worse and worse penalties until the entire Empire declares war on you because you're the worst emperor since the guy who let Grom, Tokyo, drift around Nuln for a few months. You can spend it in random events, raise it in random events, and you lose three of it whenever you confederate. Finally, prestige is a resource like money. Spending it in random events can prevent civil wars or help out the Elector Counts, and you can use it to increase relationships between other Empire factions. So with three different resources and bars to keep track of, why do I think this system is mediocre at best? Well, if you were paying attention, you'll notice how many times I said random events come into play. I like random events in games. They can force you into difficult situations and create something cool. The problem is, the Empire system is almost nothing but random events. If you don't keep prestige stockpiled, a random event can occur that either demolishes your treasury early game or forces you into a war you can't afford because Grom's decided the Empire could use another working over. Or the Elector Counts are going to war with each other, which will further lower authority, which you could have stopped if you had enough prestige. You can spend it to improve relations with other Electors and keep them fighting, but there's so many of them that early on, blowing it this way might not cover enough of the Electors to prevent a war from breaking out anyways. And with the Imperial Authority, there's plenty of issues there too. To Three's credit, it's a lot easier to raise it, or at least it seems to me. Giving an Elector back their settlement that's been captured or raised does raise your authority as well as their fealty with you. And their random events don't seem to be as negative towards your authority as they used to be in 2. But situations that cause you to lose authority come up so frequently that spending it is almost always a bad idea. And with a confederating with authority, a loss of 3 authority is huge. It can send you straight into the negatives if you don't have much in the positives, and if you're already in a deficit, you can get some serious penalties on top of the Confederation Order and Relations debuffs every faction gets. And because you also can't confederate most Imperial factions normally, you're forced to use authority. It serves almost no purpose beyond being confederation money and to get lowered by random events. The basic ideas of the mechanics are very cool and interesting, but as it is, they feel like a potentially interesting system that currently only makes an Imperial playthrough harder. At the very least, there could be some more bars for the Empire a la the Dwarf rework, so there's more tiers of benefits if your authority is sky high. Also, prestige is absolutely useless after you confederate the electors. It doesn't work on other factions like High Elf influence, and by that point in the game, the occasional random event that you need to spend prestige on doesn't matter because you'll have so much of it stockpiled. If you could spend some prestige or authority to do something like construct a building or apply temporary buffs, that'd make Karl's status as the greatest statesman of the old world come across a lot more. As it is, these currencies and numbers exist almost purely to be lowered in random events. It's frustrating because, like I said, there's a lot of interesting ideas and ways to handle these systems. As it stands, you have two currencies that early game are very frustrating and finicky to use, and late game are completely worthless. Fealty is fine, I should say. I don't really mind that mechanic existing as is. And something very much related to Imperial authority is the security of the Empire. While Reichland and Solon can be secured relatively easily, everywhere else in the damn place is an absolute war zone. And as the electors fall, so too does your authority. Khazar usually turns Middenheim into a slag heap. If Festus takes more than 5 turns in to destroy Hochland, I am amazed. And around 30 to 40 turns in, Vlad is ready to try for Emperor again. He's got quite a few electors to bulldoze through till he gets to Altdorf, but they're not serious opposition. They're speed bumps for him. And those are just the ones I find the most pressing. Azag and Dreicha usually end up in a war over control of Ostermark, and in case you were wondering, no, Ostermark does not win this war. Norsken raiders love to come down to Nordland and sack it after enough time passes. And my old favorite strategy in 2 of bull rushing the Bretonian faction immediately outside of Helmgard is more trouble than it's worth now, because more often than not, it'll mean you have to deal with Grom and the Wood Elves. It depends entirely on how well the Bretonians can hold out the Greenskins, and how hard the Wood Elves' status as bipolar shitheads is in play on any given turn. Why no, none of the settlements you own are bordering Athelor and Karl France. No, it has no effect on our woodland's health. Yes, I am still going to declare war on you. Thank you, Dirthu. Very cool. The Empire, in essence, is surrounded by countless threats that early on are better equipped than they are. It's a point that at least when playing them, I oftentimes feel that the Empire is the bastion realm protecting Kisla from the worst of it. They only end up at war with the world's unsexiest Slaanesh demon prince, Thrott, and maybe Azag. The Empire, meanwhile, is at war with everyone except the Skaven and the Druki, and that's only because they're so goddamn far away. Even the best ally choices you can make oftentimes get pounded off the map. Thorgrim's got a 50-50 shot of being obliterated before you can properly ally with him, and the High Elves aren't in much of a position to help being an ocean away and all that. All of these aren't guarantees, and one of my players I wiped Khazrak before he could touch Middenheim much, and Hochland kept getting retaken by other factions and Festus every few turns like it was an apartment building in Stalingrad. But it feels like more than any other default faction, the Empire is hemmed in by threats it's only barely able to handle. There was one campaign I remembered where I kept getting drawn into invasion after invasion after invasion. I would deal with one faction, and then another that were neighboring them would declare war on me. This kept going until I'd conquered all the way down from Helmgart to Skavenblight through Batonia and Astalia. Well, yes, I ended up with several provinces I turned into economic powerhouses. It felt annoying that I didn't have any agency over these conflicts. Which I suppose is very fitting to their lore, but until late into the game, the odds are pretty good that you're not going to be spearheading any invasions that you planned out. You're constantly reacting to the threats that may or may not have some kind of massive advantage against you, and because the Empire doesn't have an ocean or map edge to keep itself safe with, you just have to live with it. You can't pick and choose your battles. You have to pick and choose what wars to focus on after 5 different factions declare war on you in as many turns. More often than not, as the Empire, you'll have to split your forces across multiple different fronts at once. And I don't mean to flex my massive historical knowledge pool here, but Germans tend to not do very well when they have to fight on multiple fronts. There are other minor complaints they have with the Empire. Diplomacy with the Counts can be annoying when you have a 60-plus positive relationship with them and they still refuse a trade deal. One of the buffs for positive Imperial authority is a 5% chance for Elector Fealty to rise. How fucking impactful on gameplay is that? I love when game developers give some like a 5% buff to major mechanics like that as the only passive effect of something. They did the same exact thing with Khorne and Scarbrand's 5% chance to settle a ruin automatically. I can't be the only one who thinks that was a bad idea from the start, right? Like, those 5% chances for very impactful things aren't clever, they're just infuriating to me. But truth be told, the Empire being under such constant threat is the worst part of any of their campaigns, easily the biggest downside of picking them. You can unite the Empire and drive back the forces of darkness, but don't be surprised if it ends up being a slog to get to that point. That's about all I got for the Empire man here. If the complaining about their situation in the con section turned you away from them, please at least give them a chance playthrough. Seriously, once you do manage to get things stabilized, it's a ton of fun crusading into Norskor or the Badlands. And you can always add some mods to fix any issues you got. I recommend the Your New Empire mod list. It was sent to me in a Discord I'm in. If you're watching this video, thanks for sending me that one. You know who you are. Thank you, of course, to my channel members as well. You are the elector counts to my imperial election, giving me the support needed to cement my spot as emperor. Granted, I don't know what I'm the emperor of. Elf simping, I would presume, but it's not the month for that. Until next time, have a good one and take care out there. Did you know the Empire has 34 different contingencies for dealing with Dark Elf invasions? Look up Dark Elf Rule 34 for more info. Yeah, I'm positive I've made this joke in a video before, and yeah, I'm almost certain it was an end video joke as well. I'm doing it again. What are you gonna do about it? You've made it this far in, you can't unwatch the video.